So today we will talk about 2D analysis, more specifically with the 3D Imagier suite. So I am an associate professor in Paris, but I'm visiting a bit around the world. I was in Singapore, but now I am in Taipei, in Taiwan. So I would like to thank the NBS Academy for this nice initiative and giving me the opportunity to present my my work. So why do we start this 3D Imagier suite? It's quite an old software, actually. It started in 2006. The question was quite simple, how to analyze distances between genes in a fluorescence hybridization images. So we wanted accurate measurement, and we wanted a lot of measurement for good statistics. So we need to develop some 3D algorithm and tools to answer this. So 3D Imagier suite actually is a suite because it's a set, it's a lot of algorithm and tools. So the idea is to package algorithm in what is a core library called MCIB 3D Core, with all the algorithm and all the what is related to 3D image processing, everything related to 3D image analysis. And now another layer is more like a population of objects inside an image on how to analyze this population of objects inside the image. So now we also have a plugins. This is because we want our algorithm to be used by people. So we package our algorithm into plugins tools. So basically, the user will see the plugins, but the plugins will basically call the core algorithm. So we have a kind of a set of four different kinds of plugins. It started with processing, like a 3D filter. People may know the 3D filter. We have a couple of, we have three, four algorithms for segmentation. But we are focusing more on analysis. So this is the strength of this package is mostly analysis, on especially 3D analysis. Even though if you notice that a lot of 3D analysis algorithm may also apply to 2D, but it's not completely sure. You have to check if it's working in 2D. And some utilities are mostly for displaying 3D object. Everything is open source. You can go to the GitHub to get both the core and the plugins. If you're a developer, I will suggest you to go first to the plugins to see how the core, what class to use in the core, and how the classes are used and called inside the plugins. So I would like to acknowledge the people who develop the 3D Imagier suite. So I started with Cedric on this distances between gene project. And then the second version was with Jean. So Jean actually developed the Tango software. So it's a very integrated software for 3D analysis of a nuclear organization. So a lot of the core algorithms are based on these tools and processing tools and algorithms that we develop for Tango, that we package for to be more generic we package in a 3D Imagier suite. For me, I'm more like the supervision of these young people, and also some maintenance, try to debug, to add new features. It's a very consuming task, and I receive a lot of questions, so I try also to develop some documentation. But I apologize if the documentation is not full and not completely detailed. I will try to answer many questions in this webinar. I would like to thank Philippe André for nice ideas, discussion about analysis, and especially statistical analysis, mathematical morphology, very nice guy. And also a lot of PhD students develop some tools and algorithms for this. So the documentation, it's not complete, but it's kind of a good start if you want to know a bit more about this 2D Imagier suite. So now we have a new website in ImagerNet that will mirror the original documentation on the wiki Imagier website. So why do we need a specific algorithm for 3D? So of course, the one problem is the anisotropy in Z. So the size of the pixel in X, Y, and Z is completely different. So it can be like 3 times or 4 times larger in Z than in X, Y. So you will need to take this into account when you do some analysis and also eventually some processing. Of course, usually because of the system that will do the acquisition slice by slice, you may tend to get to have more noise in 3D images than in 2D images that are basically projection, but less noisy. And of course, the shape is a bit more complicated in 3D. You have more curvature, so it's everything a bit more complicated in 3D. And also, you have, of course, more pixels and more voxels in 3D to process. So you need a robust and a fast algorithm to process so many pixels. So 3D Imaging Suite is not the only tools or suite to do 3D analysis. There is a legacy plugin is the 3D Object Counter by Fabrice. This is still a great plugin. So it's doing, so you can do segmentation and analysis at the same time. It's working quite well. You also Bungie, MorphoLibG, that you will find some algorithm and analysis quite similar to the 3D Imaging Suite. Maybe there's some slight difference in the details or algorithm, but on the focus, maybe a bit different. Bungie is more focused on the analysis of bones. So I don't know much about this. MorphoLibG is focusing more on mathematical morphology. And IC is quite great for visualization. I use IC a lot for visualization, and there are also a lot of nice plugins, especially like for 3D spatial statistics with SODA or under tracking user. So this 3D suite is quite old, but it's quite complementary to other tools in image. So it started with filtering, because at the beginning in ImageJ it was mostly 2D. So we also wanted to do 3D filtering. That's it, we wanted to, from one pixel, to get the neighborhood in 3D, not 2D slice by slice. Because if the noise is 3D, you want to average the noise in a 3D sphere or ellipsoid, not in a 2D slice by slice manner. So for 3D filters, we use mostly median filter for 3D, for fluorescence images. It's working quite well. So basically you take one pixel, you take the neighborhood, all the neighborhood pixel in a 3D ellipsoid. So that means the size may be different in X, Y, and Z. And then you do the median or the mean. Also you can do like the classical minimum filter, maximum filter. Gaussian filter is not part of 3D Imaging Suite, but it's also a great 3D filter to use. For if you want to detect spot object, this is what we developed at the beginning of this tool, like to detect spot in a fish images. So we use mostly the top hat. So the top hat will compute the background of the image and then do the difference between the image and the background. So you will get only the spots to detect spot in the image. So the 3D filters have in the plugin name, it's called 3D Fast Filter. So it's fast because it's a multi-threaded. So it's like if you have 10 CPU, each CPU will analyze you divide your number of slices by 10, and the CPU will filter like 1/10 of the image. So if you have a lot of CPU, that's good, it can go quite fast. So the other thing is like it's an ellipsoid neighborhood, not a cube or whatever. So usually you can have a larger size in XY and smaller size in Z, just to respect the size of the image. And it was also, now it's if you use a 3D filters from the image menu, you will get 3D filters, you will get mean, median, Gaussian. So the mean, median, minimum, maximum are actually the same as the 3D fast filter. But if you use this 3D fast filter with a very large radius, like 10, 20, it will be very, very slow. Of your very big image, it's going to be very, very slow, like 10 minutes, 1 hour, depending on the size of the radius of the image. So you may have now you have a faster version, like a CLIG. I don't know how to spell this one, but CLIG, whatever, CLIG. So this one is a GPU processing. So it's very, very fast. So the only drawback is that your image need to fit into the memory of the GPU. So if you have a normal GPU, like 2, 3, 4 gigabytes, your image must fit this memory. As opposed to 3D fast filter, your image must fit the RAM of your CPU, of your computer, so you can process larger images. But GPU, CLIG is a great great plugin. So some plugins people are maybe not less aware of are the edges, and also use these edges to detect spots and to detect seeds inside objects. So if you have an image like this, so you detect the edges is just the difference between one pixel and the pixel in X, Y, and Z, and then you just sum all these differences. And the idea, you can use this to detect seeds, because the seeds may be like the center of all the edges, and you can cast our rays from the edges toward the center. So once you detect edges, you cast rays from the high value edges, and you will get values in the center, something like this, this image. And then you will just filter a bit to get a more smooth version of the center. So this edge symmetry was described in this paper. Actually, quite good to detect center of objects, of round objects in images. So for segmentation to detect seeds, we have the classical thing, of course, is a 3D local maxima. So you detect the highest value in a neighborhood. So the idea of this detecting seed is very important for segmentation. Basically, you have one seed, means you will get one object. So this is very important if objects are crowded to chain. So the idea is really one seed, one object. So you can use the 3D local maxima from the 3D fast filters. There is also a 3D maxima finder. This is the same, but for 3D data, 3D images similar to the fine maxima in imaging. But of course, it's slower because it's a 3D. But you can detect a 3D local maxima more accurately. In this image, we detect 3D local maxima. So if you have noise, you can detect local maxima here, very next to each other. If you just focus on the local maxima with maxima finder, you will focus on the best seed, the best local maxima for each object. So once you detect the seed, you can easily segment all the objects. This image is quite interesting. Maybe I just keep to this one and we'll come back. If for this image, if you want to do the thresholding, a global thresholding, if you select only one threshold to detect all the image, you will detect only maybe the brightest object. So you will need to lower the threshold to detect this object very, very faint, but you will get a lot of noise. So the idea is to detect, to try all the thresholds. Like you detect a very, very low threshold, you may detect this one, but you will get a lot of noise everywhere. And then you increase the threshold, maybe you will detect this one. And then increase, you have a very high threshold, you will detect this one. For each different threshold, you will detect different objects. So the idea is to, okay, for this threshold and this object, I just keep it. So with this iterative thing, you can detect object with having different values, having different threshold to detect. So you will get something like this. So it will detect all the objects and eventually also the noise. Because if you have a very, very low threshold, you will have to detect very small things, actually that are just noise, but that are inside the image. So the idea here is just to have a range of permitted size for the object. You will discard two small objects and you will discard two large objects. So you can get like a nice detection of all the objects inside this image. So this one is a thresholding, it's called iterative thresholding. So you can detect objects with different size, with different threshold. So, and then you use a size to filter the object you want to detect. So this idea of a mini threshold, we can have also the hysteresis. So the hysteresis is, instead of using one threshold, we use two thresholds. So if we use like this image, if we use on, you know, this image, so it's the blob, so I don't need to have the raw data from this one. So if you detect, if you get, sorry, one threshold, you may detect everything in gray. So what I put in white is like another higher threshold to detect like 100% sure white is an object. The gray is, it should be part, it may be part of an object or maybe just noise outside. So the idea of this two threshold, is there is this two threshold thing, is to get three areas. One is the background, black. One is maybe it's an object, maybe it's noise. So in gray, on white is kind 100% sure, very high threshold to ensure that is a real signal. Yeah. And then what you do is just, if you have some gray pixel connected to white pixel, okay, this is everything will become a white. So this one, everything will become white. Here also, you have a faint area, very small area of high confident threshold, high confident pixel, but you will connect all this to this kind of seal here. On this one here, there is no high confident white pixel, so you will just discard this object, and discard this object, and this one. So you will get a nice segmentation for this image. So this one is the iterative. Instead of two threshold, it's like many threshold. If you have 8-bit images, you can go up to 255 threshold. If you have a 16-bit images, it may be a bit more complicated because you don't want eventually to test all the 65,000 threshold. So you have to find some compromise for 16-bit images, but you can use this for 16-bit images. So the idea of having two threshold or having iterative threshold is to separate touching object. That is a big problem in biology. So if you have this kind of image, but actually this image and this image are the same image, it's just the display and the contrast is different from here to here. Here the contrast is focusing on the nucleus, let's say, but the two nuclei here in the division, they appear like only one object. So now, but if now we adjust the contrast on this object, actually it's two objects. So you need two threshold, one threshold to detect this object and another threshold to detect this object. So to detect this object, you may get one threshold that you detect like a big, big mess here, and you will get another threshold to detect two objects. So using some criteria, you will detect these two objects instead of this one. The criteria can be the size, or can be also the shape, or also the edges, this kind of thing. So because you will use many thresholds, so you need to find some criteria to detect objects with different thresholds. So something very classical to do segmentation is the watershed. I think that was described quite nicely by David Leblanc for the morphology during the morphology webinar, is the watershed. So the watershed is basically to get seeds and then to cluster a pixel around these seeds and try to separate zones based on the seed. So in this image, like you see some seeds that may be like a nucleoli actually, and then you may want to detect the seed and then, okay, I will try to create zones around the seed. So this is the idea of a watershed. You detect it. So here we just detect local maxima here, and then we will cluster voxels around the seed. So you will get something like this. This is far from being perfect. This is, but it's in some cases this can be quite useful. But for this kind of image, I would recommend to use more advanced segmentation, like Weka, Stardist, that is a very, very good on SetBose, also to detect a 3D object in like a tissue, a nuclei in tissue, that is very, very difficult to detect. For spot segmentation and nuclease segmentation, we have developed also some basic tools, some basic algorithm. So the idea is always to detect seeds, so local maxima, this kind of thing. And then around the seed, try to have some layers, and then so we can draw a profile around the seed. So this is the profile of the decreasing fluorescence around the seed. So it should be like kind of Gaussian. So we just fit a Gaussian and just zoom, find a threshold based on this Gaussian. So depending on the object and this object, you can create two objects. So of course, locally, there will have a different fluorescence decay, decreasing. So we may have a different local threshold around the seed. So we will detect these two objects. This one and this one. For nuclei segmentation, we develop more or less the problem of 3D nuclei segmentation. Actually, it's the 3D thing. In 2D, it's not too difficult to detect this kind of object. You just do a normal thresholding, and then you do a normal watershed, a 2D MGA watershed, and you can separate the object. So in 2D, it's working quite well. So the idea for 3D is to take the 3D image, do the projection on a 2D plane, maximum projection, do the segmentation in 2D, do the separation in 2D, and then extend the segmentation in 3D. So you will get the 3D nuclei separated in 3D based on a 2D segmentation. But of course, now just use this nice machine learning, deep learning stuff not working very well. So segmentation. So after segmentation, sometimes segmentation is not perfect. You may want to improve a bit the segmentation. So this is where we can have like a 3D mathematical morphology algorithm and tools that can be very useful. So the basic operation are erosion and deletion. So erode, you just shrink your object. And deletion, you just delete your object. So for if you use filters, the erosion is a minimum filter, deletion is a maximum filter when you use like a binary image. So to remove small region, it's what's called opening. You erode first, so you will remove small region and then delete again. To close small holes here, you will delete, so this object will be bigger, but the holes will be closed and will be closed. And then you shrink again to get the normal size. So we use this closing a lot to improve the result of segmentation. There's one problem with this closing. If the objects are very, very close, if you delete this one and this one, they may touch. This you don't want this kind of thing because you want one object to one object. So we have this plugin, this algorithm, binary close label. That is actually very useful. So it will take this object, crop it, do the deletion erosion, so the closing, and then put it back into the image. The same for this one, crop it, do the closing, put it back in the image. So at the end, you will get three objects. And don't worry about if they are touching, they are close with the closing, so the shape will be improved. So this end the first part that was most about processing and segmentation. Any burning question? the panelists?
Yes.
Yes.
So there are two questions which are a little bit similar, I think. So related to this iterative thresholding, I think you also mentioned later there's also something like local thresholding for seeds. And actually there was another question, because in image state there's also this auto-local threshold. So I think the questions are a little bit, how does iterative thresholding compare to, let's say, finding locally a threshold or something?
So it's completely different, actually. Mm-hmm. Finding a local threshold is, that means you need to find first the seed and then find a local threshold around the seed. For iterative thresholding, there is no seed. It's just threshold 10. What mm-hmm. are the objects that I can find with threshold 10? Threshold 20, what are the objects I can find with threshold 20? If the object, the size is okay, I keep it. And so on, threshold 30, 30, 30. So there's no idea of seed. It's just like testing all the threshold that you will, if you do manually, like you adjust threshold, you may change the threshold and then, oh, for this threshold, this I can find this object. For this threshold, I can find this object. So iterative thresholding will do this for you, test all the thresholds.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, this auto-local threshold in ImageJ, I think it also doesn't need seeds. It's just a sliding window, and then for small regions, it tries to find the threshold.
Yes. So, but this one is more like on patches. Yes. On this patch, I will try to find the Otsu on this patch.
Exactly.
And go mm-hmm. to. So it's working not quite well, but since it's patch based, it's not working so well in 3D. And if your object is just between two patches, maybe it's. But it's also a good alternative.
I see. Yeah, that's a good argument. Yes. Okay, there's one more open question. Maybe I just read it. Can I use filtering?
Yeah. In fact, I think that in one of your slides, there was a title with deconvolved in it, and it triggered a question, which is, can I use filtering on deconvolved image in 3D, or should I do it in the raw 3D image directly? And the person is saying, I have noise amplification.
Okay, so I think it's a philosophical question, so I don't want to go into philosophy. So for example, for this 2D, first there is the deconvolution. So for me, deconvolution is like the best filtering ever, because you know the noise, you know how the image is modified and things. So if you can do deconvolution. And maybe you won't need any filtering. In fact, if your image is, the contrast is good, don't do any filtering. Just do thresholding. If you can get the object without any filtering, and you can segment your object without filtering, just do the segmentation. Filtering is really when your image is very noisy and there is no deconvolution, or you want to do some specific enhancement like a spot. So yes. Deconvolution for me, it's kind of filtering, but I don't want to go too deep into philosophical arguments.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Then I think you can go on. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So the 3D manager, actually the 3D manager is like a tool. It's like the 2D ROI manager for images, but for 3D. Because when you detect object in 3D and then put it in the ROI manager, becoming a bit tricky because you have different ROI for different slices. So we were not very happy with the 2D ROI manager. So we just developed this simple 3D manager that actually is basically the central tool for the 3D image suite, because you can visualize your object and you can do some analysis. So 3D, the 3D suite and the 3D manager are really working together. So 3D manager is a manager for 3D objects. So the idea is to get a labeled image or segmented image, and then you add the image to the 3D manager. So you will get the list of 3D object or 3D array, just call it what you want. You can load and save this set of 3D objects as a zip file. It's a specific format, it's, you cannot read it with an image. A lot of people and myself are using this 3D manager actually for visualization. You just do the segmentation, but you want to check if your segmentation will fit nicely, will overlay nicely to the raw data to check the quality of your segmentation. I use this 3D manager for this. And also to check like a very simple, okay, I have this, what may be the best measurement for this kind of object. So the idea for 3D visualization is like for each slice, we draw our ARI, and then we can go through the slice. So for each slice, we can see what's happening, what is the segmentation for each slice of my object. Something people may not be aware of because there is no documentation. You can do like a manual classification. So yeah, you say, oh, this is an object class one, object class two, just simple manual thing. Just press 0 to 5, and you can just have an idea of, oh, this is object type one, object type two. In some cases, it can be quite useful. The idea is also you have all the measurement available. So the measurement, like the set measurement on the 3D object counter option, you have a 3D manager option where you can choose what measurement you want to do on object. So this 3D manager on most of the plugins, of course, are macro recordable, and there are also some extensions. So you can use a 3D manager to do some more extensive 3D automated analysis, but I will not detail here. Maybe it will be part of another seminar over later. So the 3D manager is just a list of objects. So you have one image, this image, you segment your, this is the raw data, you do some magical segmentation, you get the segmented image, you just add image to the error manager, so you will get, by default, the value is object 1, 2, 3, 4, and val is just the value of the object for inside the image. If case you have a hyperstack, like a 4D data, it will just focus on the channel, on the frame that is currently displayed. So you have the list of objects. So you can also do segmentation, but it's just, you have a binary image, it will just extract the different object, just label the image. So it's just a very simple thresholding and segment labeling algorithm. So here, so tree, so you have edit, like you can change the name of the object, you select all the object and then change the name of everybody. You can delete object from the list, you can erase object from the original image, you can merge two objects, you can split one object in two, so be careful, sometimes working, sometimes it's not working. If your object are really too close object, it may work, but it's not guaranteed. So for here, we have all the measurements that we can do. All these measurements actually are, you can find them also in plugins. So exactly the same algorithm. So measurement is a geometrical measurement. Quantification is the intensity. Quantify the intensity of this object in this image or any other images. The distances between objects. The angle between three objects. Maybe can be useful from time to time. Colorization, in case you have one set of objects coming from one channel, one set of objects coming from another channel, and then you put everything together and have colorization. List voxel, you just you select one or multiple objects, and then you have the list of all the voxel X, Y, Z, and the value of the object. So you can use it in the maybe in the raw image, and it's more interesting. You will get the X, Y, Z of all the voxels for this object and the value inside this image if you want to do more advanced analysis of the value. This part is more for visualization. So you select one or multiple objects. So by default, if you deselect, if you don't select any object, That means you will select all objects. So if nobody, no object is selected, if you do measure, it will measure all the objects. So no selection or all selection is the same. 3D viewer, you will just select the object and transfer them to 3D viewer. Fill stack, you will transfer them to the open stack. So that means you may want to create another image, and then you just, if you want, just want to have another image with object one and object three, just create another image, fill stack. These two, 3D viewer and fill stack, will work with the color pipette of image. So you have first to choose the color, and then you will display the color in 3D viewer and fill stack. Select all, deselect, okay. Since the visualization of the array can be quite slow, if you have a lot of objects or a lot of slices, you can off or on the visualization in this kind of image. Label, it just put the name of the object below the object in the image that are currently open. Load and save the list of objects. So you don't really need this image. You can just get the list of objects. You don't need the label image. So I think this is something a bit special to a 3D manager. You don't need this this original image, you just need the list of objects. Open save. Here you can just go directly to the option to see what you can measure. And the information about the work created, some, the link to the documentation is coming. So for example, this one, you just click measure 2D and then you will get all the information of the geometrical measurement about the objects. So for visualization, you select the object you want to visualize. Non-object equals zero. So in this case, I put three different channels. The first channel, I have one nucleus. The second channel, I have three biological chromosome regions, and I have a lot of spots. So you don't have to, you can have more than one image into one 3D manager. So you can, after it's for you to decide what to measure, what to visualize, and so, but you can have more than one label image into the 3D manager just by using add image. So the set of array will be displayed on the current slice. So for the visualization, you can visualize the contour. This is the most used option. You can visualize only the center of the object, the small sphere on the center of the object, or the bounding box of the object. The problem is inclusion. Here I select all the objects, but I have one big object that will include all the small objects inside. Since it's based on the array of images, the bigger object will kind of include all the objects, and I will only see the outside object. If you want to see all the objects inside, you need not to display the larger object. This may change in the future, but this is something you should be aware of. Also, if two objects are touching, you won't see the separation between the two objects, you will just see one continuous contour. So be careful with this, it's just like an array, so in the future it may change. For visualization, most people and myself are using this for in a complementary to a 3D viewer. That means you can select the color you want to display your object. So it can be a random color, or it can be a color based on the like the volume or any measurement you want to do on the object, or classification. So basically I use this 3D manager a lot to visualize my object with different information. So there will be a nice macro to do this kind of thing very, very soon. For analysis, so the measurements available are geometrical measurement, like the volume, area, this kind of thing, the shape. So shape like ellipses or this kind of measurement, the compactness. Of course, intensity measurement inside the different object. Object numbering, if you have two channels, some object inside of an object. You just want to count how many spots inside my nucleus or this kind of information. Relationship between objects, so that means co-localization, and also distances between objects, and of course the angle between three objects, the center of the three objects. So for the centroid, there's no big problem, just the centroid of the center of the object. And the volume, there is no big problem. It's just the number of voxels. So this is the 2D version, this is the 3D version. So I have voxels, the size is 1 by 1 by 2 micrometer cube. So you have 5 objects. So the number of voxels is 5 voxels. The volume in the micrometer is 10. Okay, there's no problem with that. Now, but there's a big problem with surface. What is the surface of this thing? I have no idea. The same, what is the perimeter of this thing? I have no idea. There are many algorithms, many implementation of how to compute the perimeter and how to compute the surface. So you choose the one you want. I'm not very confident with the meaning of area of surface or 3D object, especially for small objects. So I don't really use this information. But okay, if you want to know the number, 22 faces, how many faces can we see from outside? You just count 1, 2, 3, 4, blah, 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 22. So this is the surface in voxel, if there's any meaning with this. The number of in unit. So here it's like I face like 1 micrometer. Here I face 2 micrometer because I am in the z direction, xz direction. Here I am in the xy direction. So I just face 1 micrometer square. Here I face 2 micrometer square. So you can have the unit faces. And then you have a corrected surface that is 47, that actually may be like a smooth version. That's maybe not so stupid. This is based on this paper, surface area estimation for inside a binary image, because here we are not real object, it's just a bunch of boxes. So this is actually a corrected surface. It's actually giving maybe interesting results. So we also have the volume, the surface, the ferrite. So the ferrite is the maximal distances between 2 points of the object. So the same in 3D. So that means in 3D, what is the maximum distance? It can be in any direction. The distances to center. So if you have the center of object, so for each voxel at the contour of the object, you will get a distance. You have your many, many distances. So you can put the minimum distance, the maximum distance, the average distance, the standard deviation distance, give you an idea of the shape of the object. You can do this in 2D and of course in 3D. Compactness and sphericity. It's so now we are computing more the shape. So the shape is like, is my object very compact? Maybe like this one, or my object a bit noisy, not very compact and going any direction. So you may want to measure the degree of compactness. The simplest formula is this one, the ratio between the volume square and the surface of area cube. This is the basic formula for compactness. And this is the sphericity, just this one power 1/3. So the compactness you can compute in voxel using the volume and the area in voxel, or compute in unit if you use the volume and area in unit. You can also have a corrected compactness if you use the corrected area instead of the normal area. And of course, the idea is to have some kind of maximal object. The most compact is the sphere in 3D. There's also a nice way to compute the compactness, the same way as the corrected area, based on this paper for 2D and 2D shape in a binary image. Basically, if you have this shape, this is the ratio between, is based on the number of faces of face we can see. So here, just we have like a 27 voxel, and then this is the less number of faces we can see here. And then when the shape is not so compact, we can see a lot of faces, so the compactness will decrease. So this is the idea of this discrete compactness. So it's giving quite interesting results, maybe more interesting, more robust than this one, but maybe depending on your object, and it's up to you. But this one, maybe I will just suggest to have a look at this measurement. Ellipsoid fitting, well, so many, it seems that there are many formulas. This is the formula I use. I'm quite happy with the result I get from this one. So it just, you have the center, you compute the x, the sum of x to the center, the sum of y to the center, the sum of z to the center, and then you do some nice computation of with all these numbers. And then you can get the tree radius of this ellipsoid. So in 3D, of course, we have three radius instead of two in 2D. So there is a plugin, 3D ellipsoid fitting, that will give you, if we have this shape, we get this ellipsoid on this radius. So you will get all the information you want about the radius, the orientation of the ellipsoid with the different plane. And also like the two poles of the object, like the ferret, but based on the ellipse. So of course you can get a ferret position, this one, this one, and also the poles based on the ellipse. So it can give you an idea. The idea of ellipsoid fitting is just to smooth the shape, because maybe just you want, this is an ellipsoid basically, but it's a bit noisy because of the acquisition. And then this ellipsoid gives you a nice shape measurement, elongation. This is the ratio between the major radius and the second radius. And also the flatness between the second radius and the third radius. And also the ratio between the volume of the ellipsoid and the volume of the object. That are quite, I think, quite robust. If you have if you compute the surface of this one, maybe a bit noisy, so maybe not so correct, but if you compute the ellipsoid, it's quite robust and maybe more accurate. You also have a convex hull. So the convex hull is like the same for 3D, but in 2D, it will go and give you a convex shape of your object. So you may recognize the crazy bad volume thing. And then this is the thing that will enclose this 3D object. So this is another way to kind of smooth the shape, and you can get the ratio between the volume of the L object and the volume of the object, giving you an idea of how convex is your object. So this is based on this plugin, 3D Convex L. It just packaged into the 3D suite, but it's based on this object. The 3D moments, it's something a bit more advanced. Basically, it's the same computation as in for the ellipsoid. For the ellipsoid, basically, we just use the second order computation, the difference between x and the center. For these moments, we use more order, like the third, the s, x, 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 y, z, blah, 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 blah. So it's more complex computation based on the position toward the center. And then you have like five moments, G1, G2, and so on, that give you more description of the shape on how close it is from an ellipsoid and how far is it from an ellipsoid. So we use this, for example, to do some classification of the cell cycle of this image. So we have like the metaphase in the anaphase in green, maybe the prophase in green, and the interphase in red, based on this moment. If you just use the compactness or the elongation, maybe it's not enough to distinguish between different shapes that may be a bit close. So you may need more information to distinguish the different objects. And actually, the iterative plugin was developed to segment this kind of images. So we just try all the threshold, and then the criteria is just what is the threshold that will give me the best shape based on this moment to add to the shape. So this algorithm will both do the segmentation and do the segmentation, the classification. So yeah, this one is quite interesting. You can have a look to this publication. Intensity is very standard. So you get an object, and then you choose the current image, and then you do the measurement. So you will get the intensity measurement at the center of the object, and of course the average value, the minimum value, maximum value, standard deviation value. You have the mode also. So the mode is the most abundant value. Also, most likely, maybe the most abundant value, maybe zero. So we also have the most abundant value that is larger than zero. So it can be useful to get some information. And of course, you have the integrated density. This is the sum of all pixel values. So if I refer to images, this one is the raw integrated density. There is no integrated density. This one is the sum of all the pixel values inside the object. And of course, you can list all the values inside the image. So the idea is really to have your object, the image you want to do the intensity. So you may detect one object with one channel, you put in the 3D manager, and you want channel one, channel two. You select channel one, do the measurement. Select channel two, do the measurement. So the measurement is dependent on the current image in image. So one thing related to intensity measurement, but it's a bit different, I think, it's numbering. So you want, that means the image you want to count the pixel inside the object is not a signal image, it's an image with segmented object, with label object. So here we have some object nuclei, and then we want to count how many spots I have in this one, how many spots in this one, how many spots in this one. So it's a very simple question, but it's kind of a very classical question. So this is part of intensity. You will get the average value, you will get also the numbering. So check the option. So basically, you just count the number of different objects inside this one, for all of them, and also the volume occupied by all these objects inside this object. So for the nucleus number with the value 4, I have 68 objects, and there are 963 voxels occupied by this object. Channel frame, this means in case this image is in a hyperstack, just to remind you in which frame on which channel we did the computation. So this thing is quite useful when you have individual object, but in case you cannot really segment all the spots, and because they are very touchy and very difficult to segment, you can, in this case, you may want to use the volume of object. What are the volume of signal inside my different object here? So the number of object or the volume occupied by a signal object inside my image. We also have distances. This is why we started imaging in the first place, to get distances between genes. So of course we have a center-center distance. What we use for objects that are quite have a specific volume, we have edge or border-border distance between two objects. Of course we have center to edge object. That can be quite useful when an object is inside another object. And of course the colocalization, that is just the ratio between the colocalized pixel between the two objects. We also have, only in the plugin, not in the 3D manager, the Hausdorff distance. So when you have one object within another object, you can get this one is the largest, smallest distance, and this one is it's very complicated. I'm getting lost here. So this one is the largest, smallest distance, and maybe this one is the smallest distance, something like this, maybe the smallest distance here. But basically you will get an idea of what is the void between your object and your object, your larger object here. And here you will get, what is the void between this object and this object. In some cases, it can be quite useful. I have to check the formula to explain better. Colocalization, okay, colocalization, very, very simple. So you have some object A, you have some object B, and then you want to know what is the colocalization of all object B with all object A. So you can get something like this, like a matrix between object with value 12 in A and object with value 1 in B. What is the colocalization? Here, 49. You can also colocalization only, so for object 12, it's colocalized with object 1 in B, with the and the colocalization volume is 49. That means it's 79% of object 12 inside this image, and so on and so on. If you have multiple colocalization with multiple object, you will get multiple colons here. So you have all the colocalization or only the object with colocalization. Colocalization also, we have the surface contact. So just be careful with this. It's kind of a bit experimental, but it can sometimes it gives some interesting result. Is what is the surface contact between two objects that are not colocalizing but very close, and we want to check what is really the how close they are and what is the contact here between these two objects. So basically, it's like the how many pixels from this object are close to another pixel from this one. So of course we will compute this on this, and so we will get some information. We can get some contact surface like here, here, and here. And if the two objects are intermingled, it's a bit more complicated because this object can go inside. And so what is the contact surface? So if the two objects are like this, can give interesting result. You can get like a positive contact surface and negative contact surface. Just use it with care and try to see if it's useful for your data. So everything is explained in this paper by Jill for the Diana plugin. Yeah, 1 hour already. Question about 3D manager and analysis. Hello?
Yes, Fabrice, do you want to go ahead? Or?
Yes, about colocalization, we have the first question asking if with the 3D ROI manager you can define, let's say, two sets of objects to maybe focus on group A, group B, and get results about colocalization. Split the image, the objects over the image into two groups.
So 3D manager was designed to have only one list. If you want like two lists and to really deal with two objects with in two different images, I will recommend to use Diana. That is a nice tool that is the version 2 of Coloc of Yaka. So Diana is you have two sets of objects, so you can really focus on the what are the relationship between the two sets of objects. For 3D manager, you have only one set of objects, but you can rename population A, object 1, or population B. You can rename object or classify object coming from image A or image B. And then you can just select one object from A, one object from B, and do the colocalization. Or select all of them, but it will compute all the colocalization. So it's not the purpose of 2D imager is not really to deal with two kind of set of images, but it can work.
Okay, and I guess that with automation as well, you could save the ROIs, re-import the ROIs, and so on.
Exactly. This is the point. 2D imager is more to quickly check what's happening before automating.
Okay, another question about the labeled images. Can you import labeled images, such as the one that are generated through Stardist, import them into 3D ROI Manager? And additional question from the same person. In that case, is there a size restriction in terms of image that you can import? And what about 3D plus time? So this makes three questions.
Yeah, so good. So of course, the idea is to import any kind of label image done with any algorithm, any software. So importing label image coming from Stardist, this is what I do, because I think Stardist is very good. So this is what I do. So absolutely no problem. Something people don't know is like if you have an array inside your image, it will only import the object within the array. So maybe if you want to exclude some object not part of your analysis, you can exclude using a 2D array. Of course, it will do the same thing for all the slices. For the size, I imported like big object, big size. It may take, if you have, it's not a problem of the size of the image, it's the problem of the size of the objects. If you have one big object, it may take a long time. If you have a very big image with a lot of small objects, it can be okay. So if you have a big image with a lot of big objects, it may take ages to import, but it's working. This is why I usually focus on a smaller array to have a feeling of what's happening for this object, what are moving around for only a small subset of object. But yes, you can import a lot of array. I don't think there's a limit, like a 2 billion object. People are importing like crazy number of object. It's working. At the beginning, I didn't think it will work, but you can import like 100,000 objects. It's working, just be patient. And for time, if you have a hyper stack, it will, in the new version, it will just import the object for this particular frame on this particular channel. It will only import like a 3D image stack. So we'll focus on the one, on the current channel on the current frame. If you want to automate, you will need like a macro or something.
Okay, and finally, this is not a question, this is more like a request. You've got to know that you've got some of our viewers that are requesting to see the 3D suite in action.
Later? After the talk, is it okay?
Perfect. This was just to let you know.
yeah, this was the idea.
And there's one more question from Zara. So I think it's about like quantifying differences in distributions. So she has an example. So she has cells, let's say two cells, and in each of them she has a couple of dots. And I guess maybe there might be the same number of spots, but they may be a bit differently distributed. Do you have anything to measure this?
Yes, in the next slide.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
All right. There were more questions coming up, but I think we first have to digest them. So maybe you can proceed.
Okay, thank you. So just now try to quickly focus on other analyses that are not available in 2D Manager, just a different set of plugins. The first one is eroded volume fraction, and the second one is interaction between object and spatial statistics. I think this is referring to the previous question. So eroded volume fraction, maybe people know the Euclidean distance map. So you have one object, you have the binary version of the object. So for each pixel, you compute the distance from this pixel to the border of the object. So you have this kind of map. So the value of the pixel is the distance to the border. The eroded volume fraction is like a normalization. So all the values will go from 0 to 1. So 0 at the periphery and 1 at the center. It's kind of ranking all the distances from 0 to 1. So that means if you have object with different size, you will always have 0 to 1 information. So it's maybe quite interesting to analyze where are the objects. Are they always at the periphery? Are they always at the center? Whatever the size of the original image. So if you have one image with some spot, and do the quantification. So this is the my spot. And then I have a Euclidean distance map image. I just use the quantification tool. And then I get the value will be the distance from the object to the bound. If I do the same with the EVF, so the same object, but I use the EVF image, I will get between 0 and 1, where are they? Are they close to the periphery, like 0, or close to the center, like 0.5 or 0.6, depending on the object. So the EVF, it's maybe more interesting to compute the distribution of the object. Where are they within my volume? Are they at the periphery or at the center? So this graph is like I have layers of EVF from 0 to 0.01. How many objects do I have within the first layer? For the 10% of the closest object, the 10% of the first layer. Sorry. Yep, step. Sometimes a bit complicated. So let's say this is the first 10% voxel closest to the periphery. This one is the 20% voxel closest to periphery, and so on and so on. So we divide my image in 10%, 10%, 10%. Based on the volume, they will have all the same volume. So in the first 10%, how many spots do I have? In the second 10%, how many spots I have? So here it's done in the 1%. So we can clearly see that in this case, we have a lot of spots at the periphery. And at the center, with high values, we have less spots. And here is kind of average spot. So this is just a random spot with random values. Of course, we have the more or less the same number of spots in all the different layers. So this thing is quite good if you want to do statistics. If it's random, it's just flat. If it's not flat, it's not random. So you can say, oh, my spots are at the center, at the periphery in this case. So I use this EVF a lot. So first we have the second, we have the interaction. So we have some object. We compute some zone based on the watershed that we saw earlier. So the watershed is done like outside of the object. And then we'll get some zone around each object. And then we can compute what are the objects touching each object. So you can get this object, number 27, is in interaction with object 20, 22, and so on, with the number of contact surface, if we want, or number of this interaction, 18, 19, so. So this one is working in 3D. Everything from the beginning is working in 3D. It may work in 2D also. We'll not go further into this, just interaction between objects. If you want to do spatial statistics, so this one is based on the work from Philippe André. So basically you have three kinds of patterns, random, aggregated, or uniform. And then you want to compute distances between one object and the closest object, or distances between objects that are inside, the crosses here, and the closest object inside the image. If you compute the closest distance between one spot to another spot, if it's aggregated, you will get a lot of small distances. If it's uniform, you will get a lot of large distances. If it's random, you will get small distances and large distances. So the idea is to compare the distances you get in your data. So this one in blue, and in red is like, okay, now I have random I have the same number of spots. I have 1,000 spots in my data. I just randomly put 1,000 spots in my image, in the same structure, and I will get 1,000. So we'll get distances. So in red is the average of 1,000, 100 times I do 1,000 spots and I compute the distances. And in green is the 95% envelope. So here I just see my spots are outside, cannot be, my spots don't have the same distribution of distances as my random spot. So my spots are not randomly organized in my structure. So the same for the F image from the, I won't go into details. I will just refer you to the publication. So this one is a bit outside 3D images suite, but you have also this kind of problem. So the idea is to always compare original with your model. So your model can be random, so you compute distances. Or you can also, here we have like object green, object in red. You compute like colocalization for this one, or distances between one green object and the closest red object. This thing we also have in a 3D manager. And then we just shuffle the green object. So we take the same green object, but put in another position. And then we compute the same distances between one red object and one green object. And then we will see that the distances are completely different. So that means that we cannot explain the distances by chance, just the red object are really next to the green object. It is not because they have a lot, because here if we have a lot of red object, we may think, okay, since we have a lot, they may be close to green object. No. So here we can prove that red object are close to green object because they want to be close to red object. So this one is more part of Diana, a bit not really part of Imagé, but to give you an idea of the 3D analysis, you do some measurement, and then if you want some statistics, you compare your measurement with some model measurement that can be random or shuffle or any model. So I will finish this part of analysis. Any question? Yeah.
For now, the questions are more related to specific cases.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I guess so the idea was to give an idea, an overview of what are the questions you can ask from your image, from your data, and then now people may think, oh, I can do this, I can do this, or can I do this? So yes, maybe it's a case-by-case study.
No, I think if Tishy agrees and Mafalda as well, we can move on, maybe.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
So I would like to finish. I will go not quite fast about this. It's just an idea. It's just an idea. So now if you want to automate, if you have one image, okay, you can do 3D manager and then okay, that's it, you get your measurement. If you have 100 images or 1,000 images or different kind, you need to automate a bit, organize. So the problem, I guess, now, it's a kind of generic philosophical question of image analysis. The problem is not really how to segment, deep learning is working quite well. How to analyze, we have some kind of nice tool to do some analysis. How to analyze a lot of images. So the problem is a problem of where are my results. This is a kind of a problem. So the problem is data organization. So for data organization, the idea is to rely a lot on a database like Homero. This is a very good tool. So the idea is to create some project, you have some data set, and then you have some images inside the data set. So this is kind of basic idea of an organization. And the idea is like all the images within one data set will be analyzed the same way. This is, I think, the key point. Put all the images that should be analyzed the same way, that maybe the result will be pulled together in a same data set. So basically, you will do something like this, a raw image, you filter, blah, 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 segmentation, you get some object, and you get some information, like the measurement. Most likely, you will get some nuclei, and then you will get some the intensity of a molecule inside the nuclei, you will get some information. Basically, I think 95% of the biologists, they do this. I think they can get a lot of information from just this kind of a measurement. But how to organize this? So my view of organizing this, just a personal view. First, you have the data set with all the images you want to analyze. And then you have your protocol. So the protocol will be what we discussed before. Input, okay, you get the image. Okay, you filter the image, you remove the noise. Okay, you threshold the image. Then you label the image to get the object. So you get a first output, a first result. So the first result, it's kind of should be part of your data set. You have one data set with the raw data. Maybe you should have one data set with the segmented data, because this you will use it to do analysis. And then you do some analysis with this label data. You will get some result. And the result are, you don't put them anywhere. The result are for this image. So this result should be attached to this image. So if you understand this thing, I think your mind will be more better organized to handle a lot of images. On temporary data, just to store the result before attaching the image. So this is the idea of TAPAS, toward automated processing and analyzing the system. And this is why I want to focus on in the next few minutes. So what is a protocol? Protocol is a list of things we do to the image. So first, we input the image. Okay, of course, you will get a list of the image and it will be one by one. You input the image. Okay, and then I filter the image with this radius, with this filter. Okay, and then a threshold image with this method of auto-threshold. Okay. So I have a binary image, and then I label the image. So I get all the objects within my image, but maybe I want to remove the small object. So I just add the parameter for minimum volume. So now I have a first output, a generic output. This should be the same name as the same name as my original image, but dash seg. So I know I have image 25, blah, blah, blah. And I will have image 25, blah, 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 dash seg. So I know this seg is related to this image. And then if you just follow this kind of protocol, you won't mess up your things, and you know what things are happening. So you define a protocol, and then you define, okay, I want to apply this protocol to this data. So the data can be on your files, organized in data set, project, blah, 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 or Homero, the database. The database will follow the same protocol, dataset, project, and so on. Yes, if I just want to finish the protocol, and then I have the measurement, okay. I want to measure the volume on the substrate of my object, and I will put the result in a image folder, just temporary, and the result will have the same name as my original image 25, dash result. So I know this result, this CSV file is related to this image. If you have 105, it's quite useful to do this kind of thing. And then now I want to say, okay, this result is for this image. So I will just attach this thing to the image I am processing. This is automatic. This will automatically attach to the image I'm currently processing. And then I will just delete this temporary file. So the idea of TAPAS is to define a protocol. It's just a text file, exactly like this. This is the exact text file I use for analysis. And then you say, okay, now I will I will use this text file on this data set. Here I use Homero, but instead of Homero, think this is your folder, so it will be exactly the same. In my folder, I have two images, but I can have 100. So I will just now decide, we ask Tapas to apply the protocol to these two images, and then it will create the output. Here I have one data set for the raw data, and one data set to say, this is the label data for this data set. So because I don't want to mix the raw data and the label data. So I have another data set with the detection of the nucleus and the detection of my biological structure, here the telomeres. And then the attachment is just here. The result, I analyze the nucleus on the spot. I just attach the measurement from this object, from this measurement for the object, the spot, to this original image. So this original image, I have this result that are related and attached to this image. So of course, it's quite generic. You get the first channel, you will get the nucleus, you can quantify the intensity within the nucleus. So the trick is just to save as a temporary file this original image before thresholding. If you threshold, you will lose the original image, just save it as a temporary file, and it's just fine. So if you have two channels, you just open the first channel, save it temporary, open another channel, you do the thresholding, you get your object, do the quantification. So if you understand this, you understand Tapas, and you can do whatever you want. So the idea is, first, you have some raw data. You have to think inside your raw data, what are the structure, biological structure you want to analyze. So usually one channel will give you one structure, but in some cases, one channel can give you many structure, or one structure may be defined in many channels, but you will use one channel, one structure. Of course, the first thing is to filter and segment the structure, and then get some geometry, shape measurement of the structure, intensity of measurement of the different channel within the structure, and analysis relationship between structure and distances. This is, I think, a general protocol for biological image processing. Some final question before I try to do a quick demonstration.
Yes, I will ask one more question, and then I unfortunately have to leave because I have to go to another meeting at 11. Sorry for that.
Okay, no problem.
That management from my side. But the question I will ask, because I think it has been asked twice, it's a good one. Do you plan anything on object relationships, like spots inside cells, like parent-child relationships?
This is the numbering. For me, it's the numbering. So if you just want to know that this spot is inside object this nucleus, it's just quantification. You just take the spot and then you quantify the value within the spot using the label image nucleus. So
yes.
So the value of the pixel will be the value of the nucleus.
So you measure the intensity in the other label mask. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, I think that's actually true. That would be the trick how to do it. Yes.
Very simple.
Yeah. Okay, cool. Then Fabrice, I leave it up to you. I hope you will deal with it.
Okay, but I guess that the next step is the live demo.
Yes. So just to finish, conclusion, just 1 minute. 3D Images Suite, so it's a set of tools for 3D analysis that may work, hopefully, in 2D. Of course, some geometrical measurements are not valid in 2D. 3D Manager is kind of the main graphical interface that will link all the 3D plugins and algorithms within one thing. And of course, there are a lot of macro extensions that I will not detail here. And Tapas is just a way to automate all the things you do step by step. Tapas is kind of interesting because you separate the protocol and the data. And then so you define a protocol and say, oh, I want to apply this protocol to this data. So of course, what next will be, we will try to answer some question in the imaging forum. 3D Imaging Suite, maybe a better visualization, maybe some new plugin for association, like what is the best association, like tracking thing. And Tapas already some new module for filtering, but using, so Tapas, there are like 50 modules. Most of them are directly from a 3D Imaging Suite, but also some modules like GPU filtering, and hopefully we will try to implement some deep learning segmentation within Tapas, and maybe an obvious seminar, a webinar on this new thing. Thank you. So click exit to program. So in this short video, I show you how to use a 2D manager to display some label object that you segmented before. So here we have the raw data. So you see a nucleus with some spot in two different channels. Okay, just to display the visualization. Here I have the segmentation for the nucleus, spot channel 1 and spot channel 2. Usually people use a lookup table to display the spot with nice colors. So it's image lookup table. Usually people use 3-3-2 RGB or glass bay inverted, but it's up to you to choose the one you want. Don't forget to adjust the threshold to have a better visualization. You can use the synchronize window tool to visualize the at the same slice for all the data. I will now open the 3D manager plugins 3D. So in 3D you will get all the plugins from the 3D image suite. So here we have the 3D manager. So the 3D manager will just first check that everything is okay on your computer. And then basically it will open like a small window. This small window is will just, here we appear the list of objects and the function you can do on this object. So first we need to select an image, a labeled image, add image. Basically you can eventually rename the object so you know what is it, nucleus. And then we add a second image. Add image, you can add how many images you want. Each time you will get the list of objects for this image. You can rename them if you want. Spot A. So we will use now the third image. Add image. Spot B, so you know what you're doing. Spot B. Okay, so you have the list of all the objects. So usually people want to do, what they want to do is to get, sorry. So here you have the list of objects. So basically you want to visualize where are your spots on your original image, and then to check the quality of your segmentation. So we have the nucleus. If you want to display the nucleus on this original image, so we need to activate the ROI, so live ROI on. So the ROI, you can choose between many display for ROI. Contour, sphere, just a small spot at the center. The center, the one point at the center, or the bony box. Usually I prefer contour. I select the image, and then I select what I want to display. You need eventually to click many times to refresh a bit the display. And then if you change the slice, the ROI of the object will be displayed on the original image or any image. So you can check the quality of this segmentation. Of course, you can change an image display on this one. So I just select this image, maybe I just refresh a bit the display, the ROI. So I see where are my spots according to my nucleus. I can of course display spots. So let's display spot A. So of course on this image corresponding to this object, on this image. So here I have the spot A on this original image. Yes, easy. And then don't forget, you can always change the color of the selection with edit option colors. So you have the color, the foreground, the background for the here, this color picker, on the color of the selection. And it should be like instantly. So you can choose the color you want. So magenta. Okay, so now, so you can display the ROI on any image you want. If you want like a 3D visualization, so maybe we start with the nucleus. We want to visualize the nucleus in 3D using 3D viewer. So first we need to select the colors we want to display for the nucleus. So let's display like blue for the nucleus. And then just select the object and select 3D viewer. So it will open 3D viewer and you will get your object displayed in the 3D viewer. Eventually you can change color inside the 3D viewer if you want. So now we will display the spots. So spot A first, so maybe we change color in green. So first we display spot A in green. Okay, select all spot A, 3D viewer. So we will get the 3D view, all the spots in 3D viewer displayed, but of course the spots are inside the nucleus, so we don't see them. We need to make like the nucleus like transparent. So change transparency, and then maybe like 50% transparency, it should be okay for the nucleus. It's not very clear this one. What you can do also is, so select the nucleus. You can also select the nucleus on shade surface. That means sometimes the transparency doesn't work very well. So you can just remove the shading from the nucleus, so you see through the triangles making the mesh. So you will see all your spots. So we do the same for spot B. We change the color, of course, which is red, and then 3D viewer. So it takes some time to display all the different objects. So now you have all your objects displayed inside your image. Usually what I do is like I smooth a bit the object, so there are less pixel, less voxel, just smooth control. You just select all meshes or the mesh you want, and then you like 10 or 20, usually it's quite enough. Okay, so now your object are a bit smooth inside the image. Is it? Let's do it again. Smooth all meshes. Usually, it's better to click than put the number here, just the way it is. Okay, so all your objects are split. You can now just save a text snapshot, record a rotation, and then you can put it in your presentation. So that's the end of the ROI manager for visualization. In the next video, maybe we'll just have a look at some analysis. So here the recording. So thank you. In this second part of demonstration of 3D manager, we will have a look at the measurement we can do. So the measurement can be accessible here through the options. So you have the kind of a similar list of measurement from a 2D object counter or set measurement, volume, surface, compactness, fit ellipse, 2D moment, convex hull can be slow, degraded density, so on and so on. Distance to surface, center of mass, object numbering. In case you have spots inside big object, you can easily count the number of this object inside this object. Bounding box, radial distance. So what is the distance of the, if we draw a radius from the center from to this object inside this object, in case it's a sphere. And so on and so on. Of course, you can load and save the list of objects you want. So first, we just want to have the measurement of the nucleus. Nothing fancy. Like all the measurement already. Bit difficult to get this. Okay, like this. So you have all the measurement. The voltage measurement are usually in a unit if you take into account the calibration X, Y, and Z, or in pixel. So here you have the line number, the name of the object, the label, so the original value of the pixel in the segmented image. The type in case we want to do some classification. So now if we want to measure the spot, so we select all the spots, so we select everything except the first one, measure 3D. Note that if you select all or deselect, if nothing is selected, that means all the objects are selected and the measurement will be done on all objects. So you can select all and just control, remove the first one on measure 3D. So you will get a lot of measurement. What is quite interesting, you can sort the measurement. So you can select a column and then see what measurement you want to sort from the smallest or the largest value. If you have this kind of not a number symbol, it means the computation could not be done with this object. This one is a distance to center, so maybe most likely the center of the object is not inside the object, so the measurement cannot be done. So now we have like two objects that are maybe quite big, so maybe have a look. Maybe they are just merged objects or they are quite big objects. So we have these two objects. We can save as a CSV file to be imported in Excel to all the objects, all the measurements, or the measurement for this selection. We can show the object onto the original image. So now the three objects that are selected, eventually we may want to have a look where they are inside this image. So we need to refresh. So actually, yes, three big objects here. So so these three objects, maybe we just have to remind us that they are big. So we will just kind of classify them as, so just select the window, just press one. And so the objects are selected as type one. So in case you do some measurement, you remember, oh, these objects are big, it's kind of special object and may do something. The nucleus can be classified as a two or something. If you press zero, you remove the classification. Yes, so the classification, quantification, so just maybe some numbering. So we select this object, and okay, so we select the nucleus and we want to count the number of this object inside the nucleus. So this object will serve like a quantification. We quantify the number. Quantification can be either the raw signal or this kind of label data. So we just select this image. So inside this object, we do some quantification. So of course, we will get all the values for the intensity, but it's not relevant in this case. So we are more interested in like the number of objects. So inside this object, inside this image, we have 40 objects. On the number, the volume occupied by this object inside this big one is 3000 voxels. So we can do the same for this one. The same quantification. So here we have 45 objects occupying like 2000 voxels. Of course, maybe we want to do some distances. So distances between the nucleus, maybe distances within object, within spot. So we select spot A first. Distances, that means we will compute all the possible distances between objects, so it can take some time. Here we have not too many objects which are black here, but here you see the display. So it will compute that the center-center distance, the border-border distance between all the possible pair of objects. So you have to read like two line by two line. So first line and second line between, between object this object and this object. So object number two and object number three. So here you see the type. So here this is a big object, remember. So between spot A1 and spot A2. So the center distance, the center to border, the center of this object to the border of this one. And here we have the center of the object two to border object one, border. And the closest. So the closest to object one is object 41. Closest as in center or closest as in border is object number 8 within the list. So it's object B7 and object S7. It should be. Yeah. It should be only on the selection, but it seems that it's like all the objects. I have to check this one. For colocalization, so this is the same, of course, colocalization we need between all the A and all the B. So it so maybe it's be a bit crazy, so we won't do it. So for colocalization, maybe we can use another plugin 3D multicoloc. That's all. So we have object, so we need to rename these two images. So this one is A, and this one is B. So plugins 3D multicoloc, and so between A and B. So we will display only objects that are colocalized. So here we have the result. So it starts with object 1. So object with label 1 inside this image is colocalized with object with label 7 in image B, with the percentage, so like 15% of object 1 is colocalized with object 2, and there is no colocalization with another object. This one is colocalized with object 33 on object 5, and so on and so on. So collecting distances, I think this is all we want for now, all the measurement. Thank you. In the third part of demonstration of the 3D Image Suite, we will look at the information we can get from the 3D AVF distribution. So first we need to compute the AVF of this object to see the different layers. So plugins 3D distance map, actually the AVF is a normalized distance map, so we can show both in this for this example. So for this image the mask is the same and the threshold is a 0 because the value is 1. We can compute the AVF and DT outside the object, but here it's inside. So we have the two images for the EVF and the EDT. So this one is the Euclidean distance transform, this one is the volume fraction. So usually we use kind of a fire lookup table to visualize the information. Go to the middle slice. Up. So here you can see the value of the pixel is the distance from this voxel to the border. And the value of this pixel is the value between 0 and 1. 0 means the voxel the closest to the periphery, and 1 means the voxel farthest from the periphery. So if it's 0.5, means this object is like in the 50%, 53% closest to the periphery. This one is inside the 24% closest to the perimeter. So thanks to this one, we can draw some layers like the 10% of object closest to the periphery, the 10% to 20% closest to the periphery, 20% to 30%, and so on, to be layers of equal volumes, closest to, with a different, the same volume, a different, closest to the periphery. The 10%, the volume, first volume closest to the periphery, the second volume, 10% to 20% closest to the periphery, and so on, and so on. So we can divide this object in layers of equal volume closest to the periphery. With this one, the value is just linear, so it's not working, the volume will be different. So now we have our EVF information, we have our images where we want to see where are the spots within this object. So we select 3D EVF distribution. So here we will just look 0.2 every 20% because we don't have too many objects. So the EVF image is EVF. The image we want to compute is A, and we want to compute the density. Here we have objects, a label image, so we want to compute the density. In case you have fluorescence, you may want to have an idea of the fluorescence distribution within the layers. Here we have the density. Okay. So here we have the density, so that means in the first 20%, in the first 40%, we don't have too many objects. But in from the 60% to 100, we have most of the object within inside of the center for this object. If it was like a random distribution of object, we will get like a flat distribution of all the object within this object. This is just the volume, as I mentioned before, the volume of all different layers. 0, 10, 10, 20, in this case 0, 20, 24, and so on and so on. But you see the layers are quite, due to numerical errors, the layers don't have exactly the same volumes, but quite close. And of course, you can use this if you want to correct eventually this information. So this was the first part, the third part of the 3D manager, 3D part of 3D Magisys demonstration. Thank you.